Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Ask Huda. I'm your host, Jameel Rashid, and I'm happy to welcome back with us today Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair for being with us, Sheikh.
Jazakum.
Okay, good news today. We're going to finally finish off the emails that we received from you, but you're not allowed to telephone us. We won't be able to take any of your calls. The good news is that our emails are open again, so please send your emails into us at ask@huda.tv. Now, we've got a few rules and regulations for the emails. If you're going to send the emails, please, if you're going to send them, put your name and where you're sending the email from. And remember that not always can we air your emails straight away. You have to give us up to 2 to 3 weeks for us to answer the emails. And not all of the emails will be answered. Sometimes we get so many emails which are similar, and we just take the first email that arrives on the topic. And we do not, we're not really able, shall we say, to reply to your emails with an email. We can only reply to them from Ask Huda themselves. So if you do send an email and you want to reply by email, it's not going to happen. So I do apologize about that. So please, our email address again is ask@huda.tv. Sheikh, I've got a question from Brother Miguel from Kuwait. And he's asking a question about love. He's saying, falling in love at a young age and having a relationship, is it haram in Islam?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفاه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. All praise due to Allah, we praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his last messenger. It's very obvious that the brother is new to Islam. May Allah open your heart and keep you steadfast and give you strength in your faith and your belief. Allahumma ameen. The only possible way to establish a relationship between the opposite genders in Islam is through marriage. We do not recognize and we do not approve any premarital relationship. The only way to get to know a girl is through engagement and in the presence of her mahrams. And through that, you get to know the girl, you see her a few times, she sees you, exchange questions and answers, and based on that, you make up your mind after consulting Allah through praying istikhara. Then you get married if you wish, if everything goes right. But before that, you're not allowed to establish a relationship of dating and anything after that or beyond that, because that's not permissible in Islam.
Okay, Brother Mahir from Ethiopia sends us two questions. And he's first again about love again. He says, where does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak about love, maybe between the spouses, in the Quran?
Well, the Quran is full of love. It's talking about the supremest love ever, which is loving Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me strictly. Allah would love you in return and forgive you your sins. Allah also says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. While the disbelievers love their false deities which they worship instead of Allah, the true believers are more and have a stronger love towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of all the favors He bestowed upon them, because He is their creator. Then Allah talks about the nature of the relationship between the spouses when they get married. In Surah Ar-Rum, Allah the Almighty says, وَمِنْ آيَتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. And the meaning of this verse, and amongst his signs that he has created for you from amongst yourselves, spouses, azwajan, and he created between you mawadda wa rahma. This is love and compassion and mercy. So that you find repose in them. These are some of the signs of Allah the Almighty for people who reflect and ponder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ وَالْحَرْثِ ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. This is not love, which is a love of the worldly material. It's a fact. Humans were inclined into the love of things that they love to possess, to own, to pile up, such as wealth, branded horses, cultivated lands, and of course women, of course. But better than all of that is the remaining good, the ever remaining good deeds, which is some of the interpreters of the Quran saying that it is the particular dhikr of saying Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not prevent us from loving our spouses, from loving our children, from loving our parents. And instead, actually, He calls upon us to love all of that. But we should keep in mind that the biggest love in our hearts should be to Allah the Almighty and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the Sahih Hadith, ثَلَاثٌ مَّنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. There are three traits. Whosoever would have them would find the flavor of Iman, the sweetness of faith. Number one quality is to have Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more beloved to you and dearer to your heart than anything else, including your wife, your beloved children, your business, anything else. Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more beloved to you than anything else. At that you will find the sweetness of Iman. And even when you choose a friend to befriend him, or a brother to take him as your brother, or a sister, if the sister is taking another sister as a friend, it's based on the religious commitment of that individual. وَأَنْ يُحِبَّ الْمَرْأَ لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. Okay, I've got a question from Dr. Muhyiddin. He says, to improve memory, I've heard that you pray four rakats on a Thursday night, you pray Surah Yasin in the first rakah and Surah Dukhan in the second, and he goes on like this. He said, can you throw some light on this and tell us if this is really from the Sunnah? And if so, is there anything extra we can do?
I believe I'm familiar with this hadith, which is not an authentic hadith. It is attributed to Ali ibn Abi Talib, but its authenticity could never be verified. And that's why we do not base any religious practice or any act of worship as ibadah, especially like this, on unauthenticated hadith or unknown references. The hadith required the person to pray on Friday evening or the night that precedes Friday certain number of rak'ahs, and each rak'ah recites certain surahs and so on, which we don't have any reference to that. What really increases your memory is, number one, taqwa, righteousness and piety, lowering your gaze, because it does affect your memory, and supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase your memory. Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda had a problem memorizing everything that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed for him to give him a strong memory. Ever since, he did not forget a word that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Somebody is going to say, but that was the Prophet praying for Abu Hurairah. A dua is open always. You could ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever, as long as you're not asking Him for something evil or something that leads to severing the kinship and the ties of your kinship, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would answer.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. Okay, we've got another question here from Dr. Munyadeen. He asks about praying istikhara for a new job. He says, besides this istikhara, for example, are there any other du'as I can make? Because I want to leave my job and I want to get a better job, Shaykh.
Concerning making any decision, whether it is a job, marriage, travel, moving, taking a wife in marriage or a husband in marriage, these are very serious decisions, would require the person to do two things. Al-istikhara, which is a prayer that we explained repeatedly before, that you pray two rak'ahs with the intention of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala His consultation. And after you finish the salah, you make the dua, the famous dua of dua al-istikhara. Then you wait, whatever Allah would facilitate for you, that is His choice. And there is another very important thing, which is al-istishara. مَا خَابَ مَنْ إِسْتَشَارَ. One who consults wise people would never lose. People of experience, elders, people who are honest, who would not save an effort to give you their sincere advice. As in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الْمُسْتَشَارُ مُؤْتَمَن. One who's been consulted is been trusted. So one must fulfill this trust and pay the sincere advice. الدِّينُ النَّصِيحَ. So if we gather between both, consulting the wise people, the well-respected people, in addition to consulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Salatul Istikhara, that should be more than sufficient, of course.
Jazakallah, Sheikh. Okay, the last question, and really he wants some advice or some advice to the sisters who are watching. He's saying that, what advice can we give the sisters who are married and quite difficult with their husbands? So he says, you know, how can we advise them to hold on to the anger, especially with the husband, because he's given some examples that this can cause rifts and be something very severe, actually.
This is a very unique question. It's normally the other way around. Mm-hmm. But once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had an elder woman who came to visit him. It's actually, she was one of the aunts of the companions who narrated this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked her, "Adhatu zawjin anti? Are you married? Do you have a husband?" She said, "Yes." He said, "Then unzuri ayna anti minhu." See, how do you treat him? How is he to you? فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ جَنَّتُكِ أَوْ نَارُكِ. Your husband is either your heaven or your hell of fire. Meaning, he is going to be the reason for your salvation by entering paradise. Or he could be the other way around if you cause distress to him. Of course, this relationship is a mutual relationship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. The meaning of this ayah, to them, to the wives, to women, are rights similar to those which are due upon them. So as we advise the wife, we do advise the husband as well. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a very famous hadith that if the woman offers her 5 daily prayers and fasts during the month of Ramadan and obeys her husband and guards strictly her chastity, on the day of judgment, it will be said to her, enter paradise from whichever gate you choose. So, obeying the husband and being kind to him and being gentle to him, because he's a family father, is a prophetic command and it is a divine command as well. This environment of al-mawadda wal-rahma, which was mentioned in the verse of Surah Ar-Rum, could never be achieved when we feel that one of the spouses is harsh on the other and is not exchanging love and compassion with the other party.
Jazakallah, Sheikh. Okay, I've got a question from Brother Zubair from Ethiopia. He's really asking about if he's involving himself in backbiting. I want some clarification. He says that in my interaction with friends and acquaintances, unfortunately, many a time we have to start discussing about religious issues and especially about errors that some scholars make. And these errors are causing a lot of discord amongst Muslims. It's breaking up Muslims. Everybody's from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, but it's causing problems. And we really don't want this kind of person, this kind of scholars, to cause this discord. Am I allowed to now warn people about this scholar? Say, look, this guy is causing problems. Let's not go down this line. Don't take knowledge from him. Or would this be known as backbiting?
It is allowed for you, but I'm afraid that it would lead you to do the same, which is labeling another scholar that he's a backbiter and he does this and this and that. One should avoid being involved in a backbiting because it ruins his not only deeds but his good deeds as well. On the day of judgment, that could harvest all his good deeds to pay back those whom he addressed with foolishness or spread lies about them or backbited them in this life. So one should be very, very smart. As I remember once, Imam al-Shafi'i, may Allah have mercy on him, heard that somebody was backbiting him. His response was very unique, really, and it is worth of mentioning here. He bought a basket of fruits, and he went to that person's house. He knocked on his door, and he said, this is a gift for you. He said, what for? He said, man, you've been giving me all your good deeds, and I couldn't give you anything, so I bought you a basket of fruit. You're giving me what I cannot afford to give you. So now the person was reminded, what you are doing is actually you're ruining your hasanat. You are wasting your good deeds. Because on the day of judgment, every word you said against somebody else will be held accountable, will be held against you. As Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was advising him, he said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى مِلَاكِ ذَلِكَ كُلَّهِ. Shall I not tell you about the controller of all your affairs, which would really make you an upright person? He said, certainly, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grabbed hold of his own tongue and said, أمسك عليك هذا, control this. So Mu'adh ibn Jamal said, Ya Rasulullah, It's just chatting. Will we be held accountable for what we say? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very surprised that how couldn't you know that what we say will be held against us? ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُّكَ يَا مُعَاذ. This is a famous statement that they used to say when the person is dumbfounded. Don't you know that there is nothing that topples people on their faces in the fire of hell more than the harvest of what they say? So if you object to the scholar's practice or the teacher's performance, then try to abstain from what he does by not following his footsteps and doing the same yourself.
Jazakallah, Sheikh. Okay, we've got a question here from a sister about a name. She said, I've named my son Hashir for the reason that I heard someone quoting that the Prophet ﷺ once said, I am Muhammad, I am Ahmed, I am Hashir. Now, she wants to know, is this true? Is this hadith true? Or is this saying true?
I believe that she misspelled the word Hashir, because I don't recognize Hashir, but we do recognize Hashim, and the Prophet ﷺ is Hashimi. His grandfather is Hashim, and Hashim actually is not a name. It's a title he was given because he used to serve the pilgrims and the guests, and he used to give them hospitality. So by breaking the dry bread into pieces and making what's called thareed and serving them, from hashmu, from breaking the bread, the word hashama means kasara or broke down. So Hashim used to do that very regularly and frequently. So they called him Hashim as a mean of his generosity of serving people right and left, even those whom he does not know. So he was called Hashim. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hashimi. It's a beautiful name if you want to give it to your son. No problem with that.
Exactly, Hashim. Okay, the second question, of course, is related again to that name. So she's asking, can we take the names of Allah and remove some parts of it and, for example, call our child Rahman or Hadi? Is this allowed to do that, Sheikh?
You see, Allah's beautiful names are definite. If you take the name such as Hadi without the Alif Alam, it becomes indefinite. Just a Hadi, a guide, you know, that is permissible. But except some names such as the word Rahman, because we call upon him and say, Ya Rahman as-samawati wal-ardi wa rahimihima. So this is particularly for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether in the definite or the indefinite form. But I remember that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda, on the way of Hijrah, when the Meccans were chasing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion Abu Bakr, and of course Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr were disguising, they were not revealing their identity because they were after them. Somebody met them and asked Abu Bakr Siddiq, he said, who is he? He said, Hadin yahdin al-tariq. He's a Hadi, he's a guide that who guides me to my path. So he did not lie, because he was a guide. Not necessarily guiding him in the journey, but guiding him in life concerning the religious affairs. So the word Hadi is okay. While I prefer, why do we put ourselves in this risky area? Why don't we say Abdul Hadi or Abdul Rahman or Abdul Rahim?
Jazakallah, Sheikh. Okay, I've got a question from Brother Ibrahim Awal. He's saying now, he's listened to this hadith and he's given me a quotation, a part of the hadith. It's in Abu Dawood and Ahmed and others. He says, there are three which the angels will never approach: the corpse of a disbeliever, a man who wears perfume of a woman, a one who has sex until he performs wudu, has relations with his wife and doesn't perform wudu. Okay, so he says, my question is regarding this hadith, is about the perfume of a woman. What do we mean by the perfume of the woman? Nowadays, perfumes, he says, are used for men and women. Are there specific perfumes? And is this hadith actually sahih?
I'm not familiar with this hadith, and I would prefer you save it after afterward. Inshallah, we can search for it.
Okay, Jazakallah Khair, Sheikh. Okay, we have a question from Brother Feroz Kadri. Now, he says, yesterday I went to Maghrib Salah, and after performing the three rakats with the Imam, we finished our Maghrib Salah. The Imam then decided to pray Isha together. And the Imam said, because it's bad weather outside, and we have some injunction in the Sharia to do this. So he's saying, is this valid? Is there an actual injunction in the Sharia that allows us to combine that Isha and Maghrib Salah?
Yeah, it is permissible to combine the two prayers, which are possible to be combined during the journey. such as the Dhuhr and Asr together at the time of either one of them, and Maghrib and Isha together at the time of either one of them. In cases of fear, in cases of heavy rain, such as the condition which the brother is explaining here, the Imam has the right to intend to pray the Fard, the current Fard, then the next one, so that he would not give difficulty, would make it difficult or harsh on people to come back or return for Salatul Isha. It's permissible to combine the prayers in cases of rain, in cases of fear, and similar situations.
Jazakallah Shaykh. Okay, the second question from the brother. He says, in nikah, after reciting the dua of nikah, is it necessary for the male to say, "I accept"? Does he have to say something verbal? Or just by praying, making a dua, is this enough for the nikah to be accepted?
A nikah or marriage has pillars to be valid. Amongst its pillars is al-ijab wal-qabul, which is al-sigha, the form. How do you get married? Mm-hmm. Based on an offer and an acceptance. A proposal, then an agreement. In reality, whichever one begins first, the other is awaiting to give the agreement. So if the wali of the girl says, "I gave you my daughter or my girl in marriage," then without any further delay, the groom should say, "I accept." That's called qabul. Okay? So if this is the case, or if the husband asks, the groom asks the wali, "Give me your girl in marriage," and he says, "I accept." So that's called al-ijab wal-qabul, proposal and an acceptance. So from whichever one of them begins, the second must follow immediately without any interruption, with any further statement, by giving the statement of acceptance. That called nikah.
And then what about, say for example, are there anything extra he's asking put on with that? Do you have to do a dua together? Is there any specific dua, any Quran verse that they have to be recited? Anything?
I like to be very specific by the meaning. He asked about, what do I have to do to make my nikah legal and official? The pillars is al-ijab wal-qabool wal-aqidan, both the husband and the wife, her consent, of course, her wali will be her representative, and so on. But there are other sunan and traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and recommended acts, such as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give khutbatul haja, or begin by reciting certain verses and remind the audience and the husband and wife with the virtues of marriage, with the blessings of Allah the Almighty, and so on. That encourages the singles to be motivated to get married as well. Then there is a supplication that we greet both or congratulate both the husband and the wife and the wali with, such as when we address the couple, barakallahu lakuma wa baraka alaykuma wa jama' baynakuma fi khayr. May Allah bless you and bring blessings for you and cover you with His blessings, and may Allah gather you in goodness and righteousness. So this is a beautiful dua to be supplicated. And of course, during the sermon or the speech, the imam or the person who's concluded this marriage contract is recommended to recite the verses which encourage both the husband and wife to treat one another fairly and to establish love and mercy in their marriage life, to achieve the sakina which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed in the verse of Surah Ar-Rum.
Jazakallah khair. Okay, the next question is regarding the night with your wife, the first night with your wife. The brother's asking, now what's the sunnah? I mean, he said, "I've heard that we have to pray two rakahs together. Is there anything else besides this? Do we have to do anything else yet?"
And there are some prophetic traditions, such as the person is recommended to place his right palm on the forehead of the bride, then supplicate a supplication, which he, in this supplication, would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all her righteousness, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect him from whatever bad she was, that's indigenous in her, she inherited, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them. Allahumma inni as'aluka khayraha wa khayra ma jabaltaha alayhi wa a'udhu bika min sharriha wa sharri ma jabaltaha alayhi, etc. Then of course, some people think this is a night where I have to prove to myself that I'm capable to have an intimate relationship, and if I don't achieve this tonight, then I would be disgraced, and These intimate issues should be kept between you and your spouse. And you should take it very easy and simple. And I believe that I had an independent episode in the program of marriage in Islam that tackled this issue in details. Because the intimate or the sexual relationship between the spouses is not a matter of a battle or something that you want to achieve and run away. No. It's all about good emotions, mm-hmm. about feeling. So you begin with, the Prophet ﷺ taught us to begin by good words, kissing and hugging. What they call it nowadays, foreplay, and they have books, they author books mm-hmm. and programs on that. The Prophet ﷺ taught us the best way to handle this, not only the first night, but on every single night, and to maintain a happy life performing sexually. The Prophet ﷺ also reminded the husband that once you have your own sexual discharge and you have reached your climax, that doesn't mean that it's over. But you have to wait, you should not withdraw, you have to wait until you make sure that your party too has reached her climax. These are very important issues and they are discussed in details in a beautiful book called Tuhfatul Arus. I truly advise every couple who are about to get married to read these useful books instead of reading filthy materials.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, we've got the last question here. The brother says, I've got a friend who lives in the UK. He got married in Africa. After the nikah, he didn't spend any time with his wife. He went straight back to the UK. He's been there for several months now. He wants to know, is this nikah still valid? Is there any Islamic ruling on the type of, on the time they have to spend together before he leaves?
The nikah is valid as long as all the conditions were fulfilled, such as the ijab and the qabul, as we said before, mm-hmm. and the approval, the consent of both of them, and the male witnesses, and the wali. Mm-hmm. Now, the issue of being apart from his wife for so long, this is an issue which Islam handled properly. What we see nowadays is that husbands leave their wives for years. They go away to work and sometimes they get married there. They don't inform or they inform their wives. They establish life and they just send some money, wire some money to their wives and kids perhaps. This is not fair. Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, once while he was walking in the streets of Al-Madina, he heard the cry of a woman. She was making a very beautiful, delicate poem. And she was missing her husband so much. And she said, if it is not the fear of Allah the Almighty, most likely I would have been committed a sin. So Umar ibn Khattab consulted his daughter, who was the Prophet's wife, Hafsa, radiallahu ta'ala anha ardaha, as how much time, how long is the period that a woman could be patient for her husband's absence. She said, 4 months or 6 months in two different narrations. So Umar ibn Khattab realized that this woman's husband was actually on the battlefield. He joined the military. So he wrote letters to all his commanders and to the leaders of the army that any Muslim soldier should not spend on the battlefield more than 4 months. And let's say a month going and a month coming back, so totally 6 months. You should not exceed this period of time. Why? Because you keep in mind that your wife too has rights upon you. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ لِأَهْلِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ. Your wife too has rights upon you. So you have to give everyone their due rights. Allah, your wife, yourself, your body, your children, and so on. There are sometimes certain conditions where there is no other way around. I'm trying to establish my paperwork, I'm trying to establish my job, I'm trying to get a house, get a better pay, and so on. If there is a mutual understanding and an agreement between them, their marriage is still the same and no problem. Now we move to another area, which is, what if the husband is gone? And we don't know where is he at. He doesn't even contact his wife. Or he does, and he doesn't want to come back. Mm-hmm. We wait for 1 year, then we take the case to the court. The judge would give him a period of time, because there is a hukm in Islam which is called al-ila, where if the person swears not to contact his wife sexually for 4 months, the judge would force him to contact his wife, because she too has rights, not only him, or otherwise he would divorce her. So we do not go to this solution unless if the man is neglecting his wife and he doesn't want to come back, and the wife is objecting. But if it is okay with her, then there is no problem at all.
JazakAllah Shaykh. Okay, with that, we're going to take a short break and inshallah return in a couple of minutes. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Ask Huda. And let me just remind you again, no telephone calls today. We're just finishing off your emails. And if you do have emails, please send them to ask@huda.tv. Sheikh, I've got a question here from Brother Abdullah, name from Naimi in Niger. He's an air traffic controller, and he says sometimes in my job, due to the importance of his job, he says it's very difficult for me to pray my salah actually on time. Is this a valuable reason? Is this a reason that the Sharia allows him to maybe join his salah or delay his salah, Sheikh?
This is indeed one of the valid reasons which would make the person allow to combine the prayers which are to be combined. As we said before, Al-Dhuhr and Al-Asr, and Maghrib and Al-Isha, these two prayers together. Because either at the time of either one of them, either in the beginning or the later one. Simply because this is a necessity, similar to a train driver, similar to a pilot, similar to a surgeon who begins his surgery and he knows that it's going to last for 6 hours, so he better praise the coming prayer with the current prayer, and that would be called jam'a. Jam'u taqdeem, praying both prayers at the time of the earlier one, keeping in mind that in this case, we do not shorten the prayer, rather we only combine while praying the prayer as regular. The four rak'ahs is four rak'ahs and without making any qasr.
JazakAllah Shaykh. Okay, the second question from the brother. He says, after starting work, I was informed that my wages have to be transferred into a bank account. Can I benefit from this bank account, basically? He says, I get interest. Can I use this interest? Can I give this interest away? Because there's no other way of me collecting my wages unless it goes into a bank account.
We have to differentiate between two things. First of all, being putting my money in the bank because of a necessity, such as this case, that I only get my salary through the bank. Fine. The second thing is taking the interest from the bank. We have first to acknowledge that this interest on my savings or my salary in the bank is riba. So I'm not allowed to benefit from this. But due to necessity, I had to deposit my salary there, or the company deposits my salary there, then I get my salary. So once it is due, I cash it immediately. As far as if there is any remaining balance due to interest or profit, this is riba, you take it and you dispense it as we said before, such as you find a hospital, an orphanage, or a school, or the front yard or the backyard of the masjid. You buy toilet paper for the masjid, that's permissible, but you do not use it in constructing the masjid itself or inside the masjid, because this is an earning which is haram. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allah ta'ala tayyib. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Inna Allah ta'ala tayyib, la yaqbalu illa tayyiba. Allah is good and He only accepts from the charity which is good from lawful sources.
JazakAllah Shaykh. Okay, we've got a couple of questions from Brother Nasrullah from Ethiopia. Now his first is, he's asking about reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. He says, before reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, should we recite loudly or silently? He's asking about the prayers where it's...
The Basmala.
Is it loud or not, he's asking. And he's saying it's something which is, as some people recite loudly, some don't. So it's a bit of both, actually.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, or Al-Basmala as it is known, is a verse of Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's got to be recited in every single time you recite Surah Al-Fatiha. But the sunnah is to recite it within yourself. You move your lips, you move your tongue with it, but you do not recite it out loud. Imam al-Shafi'i, may Allah have mercy on him, advised that to be recited out loud. But had you Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his tradition that he used to recite Surah Al-Fatiha and Al-Basmala, of course, but in a voice that would not be heard.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, the second question, a question we've had before, but some clarification again, Sheikh. Is the Imam allowed to make a dua after the salah in congregation, or is he only allowed to make it himself, by himself?
This is a picture of ibad. Making dua is ibad. How? النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من لم يسأل الله يغضب عليه. One who does not make dua and ask from Allah, Allah is mad and angry with him. Mm-hmm. But he specified certain times, certain places, certain hows as how to make dua. This is not one of the ways of turning around after the salah and making dua in congregation. Because the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم led the prayer throughout his entire life of prophethood. There is not a single reference that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do so. Similarly, the khulafa, the rightly guided khulafa, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the prayers, and it was not reported that any of them used to do so. But I have to exempt from that if the Imam is teaching the followers, only for the purpose of teaching, because, for instance, they are new to Islam, they are reverts, they don't know how to make dua, but for a certain period of time, not to be done in congregation, because this is not a part of the salah. My biggest fear is that somebody starts doing something which he believes it sounds good. Then the followers would do it until it becomes a habit, until they believe that it is an inseparable part from the ibadah itself. So that if somebody does not join the jama'ah in making dua after the salah, he would think that his salah is deficient and his salah in his ibadah is insufficient, which is not true. The etiquette of khitamu salah, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he was the imam, he would turn around to face the followers and he would say, astaghfirullah, 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 3 times. And then he would say, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. This is indeed a supplication by itself. And he advised Mu'adh ibn Jabal, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda, as saying, Ya Mu'adh, inni uhibbuk. Indeed, I love you. So do not forget to say after every salah, Allahumma a'inni, oh Allah, help me. To do what? Ala dhikrika, to remember you. وَشُكْرِكَ and to be grateful to you. وَحُسْنِ عِبَادَتِكَ and to worship you the best way. So after that you recite Ayatul Kursi and قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ and مُعَوِّذَتَيْنَ and you say SubhanAllah 33 times, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Allahu Akbar 33 times. Then you say the famous seal of the 100, which is La ilaha illallah, وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَا لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. This is the etiquette of khitam al-salah. Adding to that is not from the sunnah or from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, the last question from the brother is regarding Friday. Now, he says there's so many different opinions on how to make adhan on a Friday. He said some mosques make an adhan a couple of hours before the khutbah, then another one on the khutbah. Some make the adhan just before the khutbah, and then people pray two rakats. Please help him, Sheikh. He's a bit confused here.
We have to understand initially that Al-Jumu'ah has one adhan, which is similar to the adhan of Salat al-Dhuhr, mm-hmm. on its proper time, on the time of the Dhuhr. Yet, Uthman ibn Affan, may Allah be pleased with him, the third caliph, found that people were busy in the market and they wouldn't hear the adhan. So he sent a caller who would call the adhan in the market perhaps 15, 20 minutes ahead of the real adhan, mm-hmm. which is the announcement of the beginning of khutbatul jum'ah, so that people would be aware of the salah and would leave behind their businesses. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. Once you hear the call to the prayer on Friday, then إِسْعَوْا, go إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, to the remembrance of Allah, which is as-salah, and listening to the khutbah, and leave behind an abundant business and trade. So the purpose of adding this adhan at the time of Uthman ibn Affan was to alert the people in the markets mm-hmm. about the time of the salah, since they didn't have time, they didn't have watches. Ever since we're following the same, some people do not do it, that's perfectly fine. Some people still do it, it is fine as well, because it was prescribed by one of Khulafa'u Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and their ijtihad was accepted by the entire ummah, so that is approved as well. But it should not be 2 hours. It should be 15, 20 minutes before before the actual adhan. There is another very important notice which is worthy of mentioning here, which is some people think that there is actually a sunnah or a specific prayer between the first adhan and the second adhan, which is not true. Whenever you enter the masjid, there is tahiyatul masjid. And the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam on Friday, any of them who would come early, would pray nafl and tatawwa as many rak'ahs as they want until it is the adhan. But there is no specific prescribed sunnah before Jum'ah. And this is for the informations of many of the viewers who assume, because many were born and raised this way, they will be sitting in the masjid. And whenever the adhan has been called, the first adhan, they will get up to pray sunnah. What is this? It's sunnatul Jum'ah. A sunnah for Salatul Jum'ah is to be offered after the Salah, not before.
So just what is actually the sunnah for Jum'ah Salah, Sheikh? Is it, I've got a question just right after. Is it to be done in the mosque, or do you actually have to do it outside of the mosque?
Hadu Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his tradition concerning al-Nawafil is to save them, to pray them at home. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, don't you make your homes similar to graves, the graveyard. How? What is the similarity between one's house and the graveyard? In the graveyard, we're not allowed to pray in the graves. Okay? So now, if I do not pray at home at all, I pray all the nawafil outside, I have made my house similar to the grave because I don't pray in both of them. So save some of the nawafil. The Prophet ﷺ used to pray the sunnah at his house, then would go out to the fard. He was reported, though, is praying once here and once there. It is not a must, it is permissible. But save some of the nawafil or the sunan, the volunteer prayers, to be offered at home. And that's why the companions who narrated how he prayed the sunnah after Jum'ah, they said that he used to pray four rak'ahs after Jum'ah because they've seen him in the masjid praying four rak'ahs. And his wife narrated that he used to pray two rak'ahs after Jum'ah. So they said, well, if you pray the sunnah in the masjid, you pray four, two by two. And if you save it until you go home, you pray just two rak'ahs.
JazakAllah. Speaking about the graveyard, the next question is about Salat al-Janazah. So it leads on perfectly fine. During Salat al-Janazah, funeral prayer, some people make taslim on both sides after the Salah. Some people only make it on one side. What's the correct way of reading Salat al-Janazah, Sheikh?
They require taslim for Salat al-Janazah to end up the Salah is only one taslim to the right. What if the Imam does two taslims? Follow him, it would not hurt. But if you're praying behind an Imam who's making one taslim, you only make one taslim. If you're praying by yourself, you do the one taslim to the right, and that would be sufficient.
JazakAllah, Sheikh. Okay, we've got a question from Brother Abdullah. He says, how do we reconcile all events that are happening around the world against Islam? Are we supposed to just make dua? Is there nothing else we can do? Should we protest? Should we not be proactive in helping our oppressed brothers and sisters?
The most important activity a Muslim should do to help this ummah to come out of this calamity and this stress is to begin by himself. Begin by yourself. Begin by your wife. Begin by your children, your family members, then expand further, widen the circle. If you can do that, the problem with the Muslim ummah or the Muslim nation nowadays is the nucleus, which is the family. We have to begin by that. I don't see that the non-Muslims are forcing my daughter to show her belly button. I don't see that the enemies are forcing my son to smoke. Yes, they are manipulating their mind, the mind of the youth. There is a pressure through the media, through the propaganda machine, through so many things in our environment. But my role I have to play, which is كلكم راعٍ وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيتي. I have to spend much more time with my family to educate them, to alert them, to bring the awareness of Allah and His presence in their mind. I have to make sure that I only deal with halal. I eat from halal. I feed my family from halal. I earn from halal. So that my earning, my spending, everything will be accepted. If every single Muslim does so and advises others with that, this ummah soon will prosper. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. All mankind are in loss, are losers, except those whom Allah exempted. Who are they? الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. Those who believed in the oneness of Allah and in the last day. Those who do good righteous deeds. And amongst the best good righteous deeds, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasized in this surah, تواصوا بالحق. They enjoin one another to what's right. And they enjoin one another to patience. Then, it is very important to be aware of the needs of the Muslim ummah and to bring this awareness to your family members, especially their children. You see, the Muslim ummah went through calamities much severer than what we're going through right now. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared one single person, such as Salahuddin al-Ayyubi or Muhammad al-Fatih. And many examples like them. They are not the only examples, but there are many like them throughout the Islamic history. Why don't you always keep in mind that I would like my son to be another Salahuddin? Why don't you like to wish that your daughter would make a revolution amongst women and would spread the awareness of the importance of wearing hijab, of being modest, of eliminating these evil fashions from the society? Could one person do that? Yes, one person could do that. If I wasn't able to do it, if my parents did not really bring this awareness into my mind, it is my turn now to inspire my son. If we read about the biography of Salahuddin and how his parents raised him, we'll figure out that why don't we have another Salahuddin? Because we're not doing like what his parents used to do. We're not dealing with our children the same. Many of us, all what we think about, I just want my son to be an MD. And that's why when you ask the youth in the high school, just they're getting ready to go to college or school, what would you like to be in the future? One would say a dentist, one would say a lawyer, one would say a physician. What happened to other careers? What happened to a Quranic teacher? What happened to be an imam? It's not in the mind of the vast majority of the youth. Why? Their parents inspired them this way. I want you to study. I want you to study hard. I want you to be good in tennis. I want you to be good in piano. I want you to be good in science. But what about the Quran? Then we come back, recline, and say, may Allah give victory to this ummah. Through whom? Remember, Allah the Almighty says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah is not going to change our condition unless if we're willing to change. And this will is not mere statement. It's not sufficient to say, I wish. You have to act upon it. You have to have a great will. And whosoever have a will has a way. Look at Imam al-Shafi'i's mother. May Allah have mercy on both of them. You know, we really should specify a whole series to talk about how al-Shafi'i's mother raised this orphan to be a leader for mankind, to be one of the greatest imams ever. Subhanallah, one word could change the course of the life of a person. From a successful businessman to both successful businessman and a religious leader. That was al-Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him. He was going to the market once. He was very good in trade, especially in silk. So once one of the scholars by the name of Sha'bi met him and said, where are you going? What are you up to? He said, I'm going to the market. He said, whom do you spend time with? إِلَمَا تَخْتَلِفْ. Whom do you hang around with? He said, in the market. He said, I don't mean that. I said, as far as seeking knowledge. Seeking knowledge? That did not really cross his mind, and he was very intelligent. So this one single word brought to the mind of Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, the awareness of the importance of seeking knowledge. Guess what? Imam Abu Hanifa has become much greater and more famous than al-Sha'bi, the one who inspired him. So enjoying enjoying one another to what's right, and enjoying one another to patience, and of course a dua, the power of dua, which is neglected. Many people think we've been praying, there's no response. No, pray more and more and more. Allah loves to hear from us. Allah loves to know that we are in need for Him. مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهِ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. And I see this opportunity and I raise my hands and I ask Allah the Almighty to bring victory to this ummah and bring iman back to our homes, to our houses, to our hearts, and save our children, our youth, our wives, our brothers and sisters, to give victory to this ummah, to free the captives, and to make us better believers. Allahumma ameen.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh, for that. Okay, the last question for today is Brother Abdullah's second question. He said, what types of clothing are allowed to be worn in Islam? Now, he says some people say the sunnah is to wear thobe and the like. If I wear a loose shirt and a loose pair of trousers, which covers my aura, he's asking, isn't this enough or do I have to wear a thobe and so forth?
What's required is to cover the aura. Loose shirt and pants that cover the aura properly, that is permissible. This is, of course, as far as men and women. And we said before that women should cover from head to toe. And that means that would require her to wear loose clothes, unattractive clothes. But as far as men, because the brother is asking, some people think that I have to wear the long qamis and I have to wear the imama or the turban. You see, we have the description of how the Prophet ﷺ used to dress up. If you love him so much and you like to copy him, may Allah bless you. Barakallah fiqh. But if somebody else, due to the time, the work we do, our performance, would like to wear different dress code, that is permissible as well, as long as that covers the awrah properly.
Jazakallah Shaykh for all your answers today and your beautiful advice. Well, that's all the time we have today. We've just completed your email. So please, yes, email us again. Our email address is ask@huda.tv. I look forward to reading some of those in the near future. Well, until then, I'll leave you with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
Jazakallah Shaykh.